And listen as our choir sings a medley about the name of Jesus. So much. Choir, take your hymnals, please. Page number 43, stand again. Page 43, and let's sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Page number 43. Instruments play through that a time or two. Get around and shake hands with your neighbor.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that with yonder sacred throng we at his feet may fall, we'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
If you believe that, say amen. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. And now I have Donnell to come sing for you.
Thank you, Donnell Choir, and all the players on the instruments. Good to see each of you here this morning. I know we've got some people that have returned for another try at it, second and third timers, and anybody here for the first time? All right, well, let me say a couple. It's not too early to talk about Veterans Day, I got a couple things here. Please join us in honoring the men and women who have served our country. Fifth Annual Veterans Day Welcome Home Celebration. This is at the VA in Long Beach, and Steve can tell you more about it. Open ceremony begins promptly at 11 a.m. on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month. Refreshments, door prizes, live music, a kids' corner, and so much more. And it's open to the public. Everyone is welcome, so that's one. Then there's a breakfast on the 9th, Monday the 9th at 9 a.m. at Calvary Christian, Calvary Chapel, and invites all veterans and active duty soldiers. We honor you for serving our country. Please join us for a complimentary breakfast in the Fellowship Hall at 7:45, followed by a program in the main sanctuary at 9 a.m. So there's a couple of veterans things, and I think you could probably check with Steve if you had more questions about it. All right, Steve, right up there. Am I correct, Steve? All right, so a couple of things on veterans for you. Then we've got the track of the week, What's Inside, and it's got a pumpkin being decapitated. And if you read inside, it's about what's inside the pumpkin. It's all yucky stuff. And when you make a jack-o'-lantern with a smiley face and not intending to use it to ward the evil spirits away, just for the fun of it with your kids, talks about how you take out the yucky stuff, and it compares it to salvation, how God cleans us up, amen, from the inside out. So grab a track and hand it out. Announcements, don't forget this Saturday to turn your clocks back at some time of your choosing, and you'll gain an hour. So move the clocks back 1 hour Saturday night. Got Christian directories out there. Got birthday of the week, Jerry Mitchell. And anniversaries, Don and Eggy Ruiz, tomorrow. Today, Sonny and Corazon are tomorrow. I know Sonny and Corazon have been married for 41 years. And then Donnie and Eggy, how long you guys been married? 18? 15? Congratulations. Julian, who are gone? Shirley and Jean were gone, and we vowed to sing happy anniversary to them when they returned. They've been like Davy Crockett, went off to Washington to serve a spell, fixing up the government and laws as well. Anyway, so welcome back. So let's sing happy anniversary to these. And I don't know if you guys you want to go stand by your wife, Donnie, by any chance? Or?
I just don't feel like
it. Let's sing happy anniversary. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
All right. Congratulations to all of you. Gentlemen, if you come, we'll take our Sunday morning offering. Father, we ask you to bless our offering. God, thank you for a great crowd here. Thank you for a great choir and people joining. God, a great number there. It sounds great. Thank you for all of that, for our special people that serve in the music part of the service. God, and for each person that's come, God, we're thrilled to see everybody today in God's house. Bless us, we pray. Forgive me for my sins, I ask. And God, as we render to you as part of our worship, this offering, God, might it be all used for your honor and glory. And we ask it all and pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. couple of things. Keep Sonny in prayer. He's fighting a real battle with cancer. And as far as David Galloway goes, who's also doing the same, he got some good news this week about shrinkage of tumor size, and he's doing well, tolerating treatments well, and all of that. So praise the Lord for that, and keep praying for both of these. And there are others, too, that we've mentioned from time to time, and I guess mention often. But for those two today, just thought we'd mention it. All right?
Take your hymnals one last time, please. Page 47. Page 47. Stand with us. Jesus, Lord, to me. Page 47. Kids, you're dismissed. Sing that once again.
Jesus, Jesus, Lord, to me, Master, Savior, Prince of
seated.
Everlasting and free. All that I've longed for and all I need, it's all in the name of Jesus. Care and comfort, healing and grace, it's all in the name of Jesus. Welcome, pardon, a hiding place, it's all in the name of Jesus. Warmth and sunshine, His friendship true, fulfillment and blessings untold. Hope for tomorrow and help for today. It's all in the name of Jesus. It's all in the name of Jesus.
One of the verses that I've always enjoyed and been intrigued by, I guess you'd say, is Paul's salvation statement in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 16. And if you'd like to turn there, we'll read it. 1 Timothy 1, 16. There, the Bible says this, and Paul is the speaker under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost. Howbeit for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. Let's just take a few seconds and notice some things pointed out here. Number one, he obtained mercy. Now, the definition that I always have thrown out for mercy is undeserved kindness, unmerited favor, just like grace. But since we have computers, dictionary.com, mercy, compassionate or kindly forbearance shown toward an offender, an enemy, or other person in one's power. Compassion, pity, or benevolence. Number two, the disposition to be compassionate or forbearing, an adversary, holy without mercy, if you will. The discretionary power of a judge to pardon someone or to mitigate punishment, especially to send to prison rather than invoke the death penalty. Number four, an act of kindness, compassion, or favor. Number five, something that gives evidence of divine favor, blessing. So Paul obtained that. Hey, mercy. And the Bible says right there that he was an original pattern designed by Christ. Says that, for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all long-suffering for a pattern, as a pattern, to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. So he's a pattern to us, because if you put your trust in Christ, you would be among those that had hereafter believed. So, it's an example of mercy that we see jumping out us here. Then the fact that he's a pattern to us of that mercy, and that Jesus showed forth all long suffering. And certainly we can see that he's been that. Now, I'm going to break this down into a few different parts. Now, Paul gave his salvation experience in Acts 9, 22 and 26, three chapters, that you particularly see him give his salvation testimony. Now, I want to start out and talk about that. And if you will, first thing I'm going to talk about is Paul's part in his salvation. This is for the Arminians among us. Paul's part in his salvation. Now, if you look at Acts chapter 26, and it would be in those three chapters, 26, 22, and 9, all right, now and then, maybe often. But in Acts chapter 26, verse 9, we see the following. Remember, this is Paul's part in his salvation. Acts 26, 9. I verily thought with myself that I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Verse 10.
which thing I also did in Jerusalem, and many of the saints did I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priest, and when they were put to death, I gave my voice against them. Verse 11, and I punished them oft in every synagogue and compelled them to blaspheme, and being exceedingly mad against them, I persecuted them even unto strange cities. Let's look at Acts 22:4. Acts 22:4. Remember, we're talking about Paul's part in his salvation. Verse 4, and I persecuted this way unto the death, binding and delivering into prisons both men and women. Now let's look at Acts 22:20. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consenting unto his death, and kept the raiment of them that slew him. So what do we see here? He was doing things contrary to the name of Jesus. He gave his voice against those who were believing in Jesus and put to death as in there. He compelled them to blaspheme. He persecuted them even under strange cities. That's why he's going to Damascus. He persecuted this way unto death. He bound and delivered people, both men and women. The blood of Stephen was involved in this, which is a nasty business when you start thinking of stoning somebody to death, beating him on the head with rocks and things. That's a nasty business. And he says the blood of Stephen, consenting unto his death. And he was obviously a party unto it, consenting for sure, but I would say a party of it. Now, I'm going to take a chance and read some stuff to you here from Charles Spurgeon. 1800s, kind of the mid-1800s. And I'm going to read a few words here. So I'm in a hurry, but I'm going to try not to be. I suppose, Charles Spurgeon says, a great Baptist preacher. I mean, a great Baptist preacher. I suppose there are some persons whose minds naturally incline toward the doctrine of free will. I can only say that mine inclines as naturally towards the doctrines of sovereign grace. Sometimes, when I see some of the worst characters in the street, I feel as if my heart must burst forth in tears of gratitude that God has never let me act as they have done. I have thought, if God had left me alone and had not touched me by His grace, what a great sinner I should have been. I should have run to the utmost lengths of sin, dived into the very depths of evil. Nor should I have stopped at any vice or folly if God had not restrained me. I feel that I should have been the very king of sinners if God had left me alone. I cannot understand the reason why I am saved, except upon the ground that God would have it so. I cannot, if I look so earnestly, discover any kind of reason in myself why I should be a partaker of divine grace. If I am not at this moment without Christ, it is only because Christ Jesus would have His will with me, and that will was that I should be with Him where He is and should share His glory. I can put the crown nowhere but upon the head of Him whose mighty grace has saved me from going down into the pit. Looking back on my past life, I can see that the dawning of it all was of God effectively. I took no torch with which to light the sun, but the sun enlightened me. I did not commence my spiritual life, no, I rather kicked and struggled against the things of the Spirit. When He drew me, for a time, I did not run after Him. There was a natural hatred in my soul for everything holy and good. Wooings were lost upon me. Warnings were cast to the wind. Thunders were despised. And as for the whispers of His love, they were rejected as being less than nothing and vanity. But sure I am, I can say now, speaking on behalf of myself, He only is my salvation. It was He who turned my heart and brought me down on my knees before Him. I can very deed say with Doddridge and Topley, grace taught my soul to pray and made my eyes o'erflow. And coming to this moment, I can add, 'tis grace has kept me to this day and will not let me go. Well can I remember the manner in which I learned the doctrines of grace in a single instant. Born, as all of us are by nature, an Arminian, I still believed the old things I had heard continually from the pulpit and did not see the grace of God. When I was coming to Christ, I thought I was doing it all myself. And though I sought the Lord earnestly, I had no idea that the Lord was seeking me. I do not think the young convert is at first aware of this. I can recall the very day and hour when I first received those truths into my own soul. when they were, as John Bunyan says, burnt into my heart as with a hot iron. And I can recollect how I felt that I had grown on a sudden from a babe into a man, that I had made progress in scriptural knowledge, through having found once for all, the clue to the truth of God. One weeknight, when I was sitting in the house of God, I was not thinking much about the preacher's sermon, for I did not believe it. The thought struck me, how did you come to be a Christian? I sought the Lord. But how did you come to seek the Lord? The truth flashed across my mind in a moment. I should not have sought him unless there had been some previous influence in my mind to make me seek him. I prayed, I thought, but then I asked myself, how came I to pray? I was induced to pray by reading the scriptures. How came I to read the scriptures? I did read them, but what led me to do so? Then in a moment, I saw that God was at the bottom of it all, and that he was the author of my faith, and so the whole doctrine of grace opened up to me, and from that doctrine I have not departed to this day, and I desire to make this my constant confession. I ascribe my change wholly to God. So when I talk about Paul's part in his salvation, what was his part? Hating Christ, persecuting Christ, killing Christians, chasing after them, binding them, and bringing them back to be killed. That was Paul's part in his salvation. Now, God has some appointments. And at the risk of reading way too much, I think I looked up the definition of appoint. Number one, to name or assign to a position, an office, or the like, designate. So you can appoint, if you're the president, you can appoint an ambassador and hope they get the security they need to defend them. Appoint means to determine by authority or agreement, fix, set, to appoint a time for the meeting. You can appoint somebody to an office, you can appoint a time for a meeting. And then another definition is to provide with what is necessary, equip, furnish. They appointed the house with all the latest devices. Now, God's got some appointments, and he had some for Paul. First, he had an appointment of time. He scheduled an appointment with Paul. If you turn to Acts 26, verse 15, Acts chapter 26, verse 15. Now, Paul is headed toward Damascus to take Christians and bring them back. He's got authority from the chief priests at Jerusalem. He's on his way. And is something that he is not anticipating. Whereupon, verse 12 of Acts 26, as I went to Damascus with authority and commission from the chief priest, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue. Now, let's just look at that. God, this is not some imagination in his mind. God is speaking to him in an old language in the Hebrew tongue. And he says to Paul, Saul, now his name is later changed to Paul. Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Paul is persecuting Jesus Christ. Now, if you believe your Bible, and I know you do, Jesus said to him, very plainly, why persecutest thou me? And then he says this, it's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Those pricks are cattle prods. You can kick back at the prick if you want to, but you're probably going to hurt your leg. I not always have been as smart and under control as I am now. And one day I punched a water cooler. But I happened to hit that water cooler. You know how those things are tinny? You know, they vibrate. You could probably feel like you could put a real, you know, come on, boom, put a dent in that thing. I happened to punch it where the motor was. The motor. There was a motor in there. And it's a cooling motor, I suppose. We could have Buzzy tell us all about it. But this knuckle swole up about twice its normal size. And I started to realize, you know, you're probably not going to hurt that thing by punching it. You're probably going to hurt yourself. And God says to Paul, man, you're hurting yourself. Are you hurting other people too? Sure you are. Boy, that guy, one of the guys from the Blue Jays, I was cheering for Kansas City because I try to cheer for pastor's teams, no matter what he does with mine. But this guy got a bad call behind the plate, and they showed him a few minutes later with a bat in his hand going at either a garbage can or a water cooler or something. I mean, he was going at it. Boom, boom, I mean, big time. Well, Paul was going at Christ. He was going at the Christians. And Jesus said, why are you doing this, Paul? It's hard for you to fight against me. You're not going to hurt Jesus. You're going to hurt yourself. Now, let's continue. And he said, and I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest. Well, I want you to see that Paul is not searching or seeking. In no way is he searching for Christ. The Bible says the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Paul is not seeking Christ. He's persecuting Christ. He's not searching for Christ, but Christ is searching for him. He did not make an appointment with Christ. Christ made an appointment with him. He didn't know the appointment was going to take place. And I just want you to see God's appointment of time. And then I want you to see another thing. In verse 16, we just read verse 15, we see an appointment to office. First, God made an appointment with him time-wise. Then God appointed him to an office. He says in verse 16, but rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of those things which thou hast seen. Now, he just saw Christ, if you will. He heard from Christ. And he said, look, get up. I'm going to make you a witness. I've got a purpose in your life. I've determined, and I'm appointing you an apostle for me. You have a purpose. You're going to be a witness and a testimony to the things which you've seen. And by the way, Paul, I'm going to show you some other things too. And if you've read your Bible, you know that God later caught him up to the third heaven, and he saw things which were not lawful for him to utter. He was going to see a lot. He was going to do a lot. He was going to work miracles. He was going to get stoned and beaten around and everything you can imagine. At another point, he said, I got to show him how many things you're going to suffer for Jesus Christ. But he had appointed him to an office. Now, there's no, well, let me continue, of those things for the which I will appear unto thee. Now, there's no guessing or Bible commentary needed here. God says to make thee a minister and a witness of those things which thou hast seen, and the things, again, which I will appear unto him. And that's, you can find that in 2 Corinthians 12, 1 through 4, where Paul said, it's not expedient for me, doubtless to glory. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I knew a man about 14 years ago, whether in the body I cannot tell or out of the body I cannot tell. God knoweth, such a one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body I cannot tell. God knoweth how that he was caught up in a paradise, and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. So I just want to say this. God had an appointment with him time-wise. God made that appointment. And then he had an appointment with him for an office. God made that office. He never applied for it. And then God gave an appointment of provision, all according to definition. In verse 17 in the same chapter, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles unto whom I now send thee. Unto whom now I send thee. He's going to send him to the Gentiles. Now, I hope you realize how shocking this is to the Jewish mind. Salvation is of the Jews. Okay? The Jews were God's people. He was dealing with a nation. But things are about to change. And, of course, this goes all the way back to Genesis. God never intended to eliminate those of us here that are Gentiles, which would be most of us. But Paul is going to be the apostle to the Gentiles. He's going to send him to the Gentiles. He'll go to the Jews first. He'll always go to the Jews first. And every time he does, they either try to kill him or reject him or throw him out of town or beat him or stone him or something. All of that takes place, and he goes to the Gentiles, And that's all in God's plan. Because he had an appointment for us too, amen? So he is going to go to the Gentiles. And then, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes, and to turn them from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins, and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. All of this is going on. Now, I think Spurgeon said, I don't have the record of it, but he said he did, so probably true. But he said Spurgeon used to say you're invincible until God's done with you. All right, let's balance that off with thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. I mean, let's get some good balance in there. But Paul was going to be delivered from the Gentiles according to God. They say, well, what happened to Paul eventually? I wonder what happened to my glasses. Every now and then, I'd like to take a look at you guys and see if you're listening. Boy, there's a good-looking group. What happened to Paul? God said, delivering thee from the Gentiles, and whom I have sent thee. Well, the Gentiles killed him. They cut off his head, we believe. What? Delivering thee from the Gentiles? All right. God delivered him time and time and time again. But then not again. It's appointed on a man once to die. There have been a whole bunch of martyrs for Jesus Christ. Good people. Stephen was a good guy, was preaching for the Lord, and they killed him. Paul was as good as they come, even though he said he was the chiefest of sinners. They killed him. So when we say deliverance, let's understand that God has a plan for our life. But he does not say we're going to live like Methuselah did for 969 years. Huh? He doesn't say that. So let's not take this out of context. Let's understand what's going on. God's got a purpose for Paul. He's going to take care of him to the degree that he wants to take care of him. And when it's time for Paul to go home, he's going to go home. And by the way, a lot of people have theorized that Paul had a death wish. After all, he'd been there. I don't know how nice your house is, but when Jesus says, in my Father's house are many mansions, for not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Maybe Paul had a look at his house up there and he thought it was a lot nicer than his house down here, and I don't know that he even had a house down here. Amen? And he was ready to go. He said, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. I'm in a strait betwixt two. Amen? So, Paul, I mean, I don't know that he had some death wish, but he certainly went at it pretty hard. Amen? And there came a time that God took him home. There is a time element. God delivers you until he does not deliver you. He delivers you for a purpose. Oh, he delivered me. But for a purpose. To open their eyes. To turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God. If we have been appointed an office, and we have, and we are ambassadors for Christ, then we have a function. And it's to turn people from darkness to light. It's to turn them from the power of God to Satan. We're not just saved to get drunk and live like a bunch of hedonists. Amen? We are saved to serve. Told you before, first cliche I heard in the Christian faith was from Chet Littlefield, saved to serve. Sounds good, doesn't it? Amen. Yeah, that's what we're supposed to be doing. And honestly, I think your greatest joys in life are serving Christ. Is it work? Sure it's work. Of course it is. And again, Paul was stoned at Lystra. I mean, I don't want rocks bouncing off my head. Amen? Going to have a birthday party. I don't want anybody bouncing rocks off my head. And why would he be doing that? So, okay, that's his purpose. Why? That they may receive forgiveness of sins. That they may receive forgiveness of sins. Who? Those people that are trying to kill him. He got rejected time and time again. Amen? One stone, beaten with rods, shipwrecked, all of that stuff. And once they receive forgiveness of sins, they have an inheritance. That they may receive inheritance. Look, we have a great inheritance coming us. Okay? This is not the power of positive thinking. This is the power of God as revealed in the Scriptures. Amen? He delights in blessing us. Now, we've got a little timeline here of service. And then we've got a long retirement time. I think of people that I know here, and I hate to bring it up for heartache's sake, but man, people have worked all their lives and retired a week before, died of a heart attack a week before they're going to retire, or were retired for a very short time and died. I thought, man, worked all life, had the blessings of a home life and everything. Now you're going to sit back in your easy chair and take it easy, and your life is over. Well, look, for you and me, it's going to be just the opposite. We're going to work a little while, and then we're going to be retired for eternity in heaven. You say, what are we going to be doing in heaven? You know, Buddy used to say he was sure we'd have jobs. And because I'm a sinful guy, I used to think, yeah, he's not working that hard. Because the guy's working real hard. He's not looking at retirement and saying, boy, I still want to keep working 12 hours a day. You know, Dennis is out there a lot of times. This morning he's working on floors, but he's out there working on cement. And you're breaking up cement, putting it in a wheelbarrow and hauling it around. And that's one of the reasons my bicep is shot. And, you know, you put enough cement in that wheelbarrow, it's 500 pounds in there or something. You're trying to wheel it around. If you do that for 6 or 7 hours, you're not saying, boy, I can't wait to get to heaven so I can get another laboring job. Now, are we going to be busy? We're not going to be bored. Are we going to be busy? I guess. I don't know. I just know it's going to be great. I mean, how about that, Bill? Are you looking forward to heaven so you can go dig pipes out of the ground and stuff? No, no. So, you know, depends on your perspective, right? But here we are. We're working for a little while, and we've got to stay at it. You know, we've got a job to do. We've been appointed an office. And we've got a job to do, but man, we've got eternity. You know, we take Amazing Grace when we've been there 10,000 years. And then there's song leaders, Don Bigelow and others, will change your words and say, when we've been there forevermore. Amen? Just going on and on. Now, Jeremiah says this, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Now, Buddy's favorite verse, and if I try to quote it, I might mess it up, but it's Romans 2:4, and it talks about the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance? Look, if that doesn't fit Paul perfectly, what does? So, what are we saying? Well, let's go a little further. I'll preach two messages in one. I'll put my glasses back on and look at the clock. All right. Here's a little conclusion. Acts 26:19. In Acts 26:19, we read the following. Whereupon, O King Agrippa, he's testifying before King Agrippa. He's going to be on his way to Rome. He's been captured by the Jews. He's going to go to Rome. He'll probably get released and do some more missionary work, get captured again, get his head cut off. But right now, he's testifying before Agrippa. Wherefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. Paul's manner. I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. How about a little more from Spurgeon? A little quick more. That God predestinates, and yet that man is responsible, are two facts that few can see clearly. They are believed to be inconsistent and contradictory to each other. If then I find taught in one part of the Bible that everything is foreordained, that is true. If God says it's foreordained, that is true. Amen? And if I find in another scripture that man is responsible for all his actions, that is true. And it's only my folly that leads me to imagine that these two truths can ever contradict each other. I do not believe they can ever be welded into one upon any earthly anvil, but they certainly shall be one in eternity. They are two lines that are so nearly parallel that the human mind which pursues them farthest will never discover that they converge. But they do converge, and they will meet somewhere in eternity close to the throne of God whence all truth doth spring. So when I say Paul's manner, he says, I was not disobedient. He said, wait a minute, you're talking about the grace of God. It's all grace. His time appointment, his appointment to office, his appointment for deliverance, it's all God. And now you're saying he was not disobedient, which indicates the will comes into this thing. And Spurgeon addresses that. He says, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient, and he wasn't. He said, I labored more than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which worketh in me. He went at it. That's his manner, his method. But showed, if we continue on in verse 20 of Acts 26, but showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles that they should repent and turn to God and do works for repentance. His method. He showed people. He told them. In our language, he handed out tracts. He witnessed to people. He prayed for them. In Romans 1:16, the Bible says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. He's going to Damascus, and he preaches right off the bat. Look, don't wait till you got your doctorate degree to tell somebody about Christ. Amen? When you get saved, tell them what happened to you. Tell them now. Don't wait till you've been sanctified or whatever you know, some junk that somebody wants to. When God saves you, you've already been sanctified. Amen? And I don't care how many college courses you got or anything of the kind. Tell them what you know. If you know Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, tell them that. If you know Titus 3, 5, tell them that. That's good enough. If you know John 3, tell them that. If you know John 3, 16, tell them what you know. Don't wait. Because, let me tell you, that time never comes when you're fully qualified. Don't let Satan get you on that one. He started right off the bat. He went back to Jerusalem, his old stomping grounds. Then through all the coasts of Judea, that whole area. Then to the Gentiles. And that reminds me of Acts 1:8. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon me, on you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Paul really literally did that. So his manner and his method was that. And his message is that you would repent, turn to God, and do works meet for repentance. Now, there is a decision involved in repentance. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will you also go away? I heard some hard sayings. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. I'm going to break this down this way. Repent and turn. It involves a decision, doesn't it? At some point, you've got to make a decision for Christ. That would be true for salvation. That would be true for baptism. That would be true for any service that you can name. You've got to come to a point of decision. Now, I'm calling it decision discretion. Repent and turn. You know, people can repent and turn a lot of different directions. You might repent and take a wrong turn. People have thought, man, I'm going to clean up my life. I'm going to go to AA, and that's going to be my deliverance, and I don't need the church. They can go to the Masonic lodge and say, that's all I need. I'm going to try to be a good guy and go to the Masons. You can become a good guy and go to the Mormons. You need to repent and turn to God. A repentance is a turning. But which way are you going to turn? You've got a lot of options out there, amen? You want a burger, lady? You can go to Wendy's, you can go to Jack in the Box, you can go to McDonald's, all close by. You can develop a habit. You can do a lot of things, amen? But you got to repent and turn the right way. You've got to turn to God, the Lord Jesus Christ. So there's a decision, there's discretion, and then there's direction. And all of that has to do with repent, make a call, turn around and turn to God, and then there's dedication. Do works meet for repentance. Now, if I have any more to this message, it's still in my office. I just ran out of notes. What I want to tell you is this. Paul's statement of salvation is your statement of salvation. Amen? 1 Timothy 1:16. 1 Timothy 1:16. Howbeit for this cause I obtain mercy, that in me first Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. His statement is our statement. Amen? What? That we obtain mercy. Look, I thought I was searching for God. But God was drawing me. Amen? To God be the glory. What he wrote here is your testimony. That God, by his grace, long-suffering. Is there somebody here that wants to stand up today and say, yeah, I was always a great guy. I never did anything to hurt the cause of Christ. I shouldn't say what I'm going to say, but we're having a good time. Enoch talked about the priest. He said he was a powerful guy back in the Middle Ages and following because they got this doctrine of confession. Right? And the priest knew everything about everybody in town. And what did you say? You either stay at good grounds with a priest or you get out of town. Let me tell you something. I know some of you guys. Right? No, I know you guys. What I don't like is you know me too. We did not deserve salvation, folks. We did not deserve. God made an appointment with us. He stopped us on the way, and he saved our souls. He did it. We didn't do it. We didn't do it because we were so doggone good, we got to the point where God took us in. No, we were so bad, he had to come down and stop us on the tracks and say, why are you persecuting me? We said, who are you? He said, I'm Jesus, and you're persecuting me, and you're making a fool out of yourself. You're hurting yourself. You need to turn, because I've got an appointment for you. I want you to go and preach the gospel. I want you to raise your family to serve God. I want you to live right in the United States of America or wherever you might be and be a good citizen and tell people that they need to repent, turn to God, and do works meet for repentance. That's your testimony. God did that. Amen? So what are we going to do with it? I think everybody here today is saved. We don't have any first-time visitors, but I don't know. You're going to stand before God and answer for your decision to follow him. So if you're not saved, this better be it. You have no promise of tomorrow. But if you ask me, say, yeah, I guess everybody here is saved. So then what? What? What are you preaching about? What are you yelling about? I want you to be thankful for what God did in your life. I want you to acknowledge that it was him, not you. There's none good but one, that's God. And oh, by the way, Jesus Christ is God. Amen? And we need to acknowledge that every day of our life. And thank God that he's long-suffering and full of grace and that he sought us and he bought us. Amen? They would not seek. They must be sought. They cannot buy. They must be bought. Thank God for it. Thank God that Paul's statement of salvation is mine and yours. Amen? Let's pray. God, we love you. We thank you. What a great God. Salvation is of the Lord. Oh, might we never, ever forget that. Why, thank God if we do what we should do financially. Thank God if we give of our time. Thank God if we pray and study that Bible. Thank God if we're telling others about Jesus Christ. But might we always remember in our lives, salvation is of the Lord. As Spurgeon said, he must wear the crown, not me. And Father, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts for that grace. And knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Take your hymnals.